Hi, my name is Daniel Scott, and today, in this short video, I'll tell you a life-changing story about how I figured out how to easily generate insane amounts of energy for the past 2 years. I'm talking about a simple device that can be used by any family around the world and can even change the course of the entire energy industry. Over the past year, over 100,000 people have also already successfully used a very simple technique to get over tragic milestones such as hurricanes, snowstorms, or floods. Based on technology a lot of people use on a daily basis, not only can it generate enough power to help you through long, harsh winters when temperatures outside go below zero, but it can ameliorate your power bill all year long. I'm sure you're already intrigued and you want to know all about how this system works. Honestly, it's like nothing you've ever seen, and in a few minutes from now, you'll be outraged you ever paid a single cent to Big Electric. So you absolutely need to watch this short presentation today while it's still up. I don't know how much longer I'll have this free presentation online, so watch this right now while you still can. Before we continue, let me tell you who I am and how it all started. As I mentioned before, my name is Daniel Scott. I'm a 52-year-old math teacher in Vineland, New Jersey. Folks who live here know that high energy bills are somewhat of an issue, and we have been fighting them for years. And we've never liked paying through our noses for simple things that everybody should afford, like using electric appliances without restrictions. However, we simply settled thinking, that's the economy, or maybe it'll be better next year, month after month, struggling not to fall behind on our bills. All that until the winter of 2017, December 29th, Tuesday, the absolute worst day of my life. The news warned the population about rising of the freezing waters of the Morris River, but we never had problems. We were miles from the river and we were safe. But this time it was different. Around 7 p.m., news warned everyone in the area the river had risen like never before. After a few minutes, all the lights went off. I immediately thought it was a blackout. I went to check on my wife and two daughters. They were fine for the moment. The Maurice River had broken out of its bed and flooded the surroundings. It ripped down hundreds of power lines around the area, and we suddenly found ourselves without power. My wife and I discussed driving to my parents in Lexington, Kentucky, but we were looking at a 10-hour drive in the night. We decided to wait for the power to come back. Big mistake. The house was getting cold, and it was getting cold fast. Night came, still no power. I tried calling the electric company on my cell phone to find out when power would be restored, but all I got was a pre-recorded message saying that they were aware of the problem and that it would be between 48 and 72 hours before the power would be back online. Quickly, the temperature in our house reached around 40 degrees. Around midnight, I went to check on my family, and what I saw made me freeze in my tracks. My wife and daughters were lying on the bed, embracing each other, shivering in cold, muffled in thick blankets. You can't imagine how I felt not being able to protect my family. I rushed and wrapped my arms around them as I could in a futile attempt to give them what little body heat I had. And then my five-year-old Lisa said in a shivering voice, "Daddy, I'm cold and I'm hungry. I wish we had a warm soup." I immediately burst into tears. It was the most devastating moment of my life. I felt like my world collapsed. I felt powerless because there was nothing I could do to protect the ones I cared for most, and I simply felt furious. Outraged about the fact that I knew I was the only one to blame for getting in this situation, and worse, for getting my family in this dangerous situation. I was furious that I was completely dependent on the electric company to power my home, and furious about the fact that for so many years I let it slide and thought, maybe it'll be better next year, while those money-sucking electricity mobsters bled me and my family dry. It was the moment I realized I was at the end of my rope. I swore to myself, I'd never put my wife and two daughters in a similar situation again. We left for my parents the very next day and came back after some time. I immediately began researching every single energy alternative I could find. I made it my sole purpose, because leaving my family's well-being in the hands of electric companies clearly wasn't an option anymore. Not only did their power lines always seem to go down in unexpected moments, but their prices had been smothering me for more than a decade. I imagine the CEO is going to the bank and cashing out my hard-earned money, maybe even laughing while doing it. So I immediately began to look at the problem from every angle to break the chains Big Electric had around my family. There had to be something. Frustrated, I created a list of what I felt my new source of energy should be. Cheap and easy to obtain or build. Easy to move. If I needed to bug out of town, it needed to be something I can easily carry with me. Can use a constant source of power to create energy. If there was no gas or wind, it should still work fine without interruption. So I considered buying a heavy-duty generator. It's certainly a reliable source of power, so I looked pretty much into this option. However, when I started to consider the costs, I realized I was looking at a minimum $1,000 investment to get a really high-quality generator, not to mention the fuel usage. And with fluctuating gas prices, try powering your home with a full-time generator. You'd need to use about 90 gallons of gas per month, and at a cost of around $250 or more to do it. Plus, it's not like I wanted to have a 90-gallon bomb around my family and house. So this option was off the list. Next, I considered using solar energy. I've heard the solar industry boomed over the last years, and solar panels can be really effective. And maybe you've heard, here in Vineland, New Jersey, it can be sunny for very long periods of time, and using solar panels really is an option. But when looking more into this, the first thing anyone should think of is if their rooftops can withstand the weight of the panels. And having a relatively old house built in the 1950s, renovating the rooftop to install them was too complicated altogether for me. Not to mention that installing professional panels would have cost me an easy $20,000. And I certainly didn't have the money to invest. The idea to buy a DIY wind generation kit crossed my mind, but when I saw the costs, I changed my mind. Plus, I did some research on the subject and found out that wind generators, or windmills as some people call them, need perfect wind channels, height, and weather to be efficient. So I had only one option. If I wanted to make sure my family never goes through such an experience again, I had to create my own solution. It had to be something cheap and fast and easy to build because I definitely didn't have any technical skills to build complicated devices. Being a teacher doesn't really offer those kinds of skills. So I started looking into every other solution that could bring me the security for my family. Many sleepless nights passed and I was getting tired of surfing the internet for a simple solution. Yet one day, Kate, my wife, reminded me about my late Uncle Jack and his research in the energy field. Unfortunately, he passed away in 2004. He worked for an electric car company as a pioneer in his field. His life goal was to save the planet and offer our children a better life. As a professional researcher in this domain, he had the resources he needed to do it. And setting his goal to help humankind, as he said, he dedicated his life to discovering new technology. And he did thorough research. I remember him telling me how a good battery bank is a steady and reliable source of backup electricity and could also ameliorate electric bills. And maybe that sounds a bit strange, but there are some companies who are looking into making this technology available as we speak. However, that wasn't the solution for his electric cars. And clearly, it wasn't for me either. The investment was too big, and I certainly wasn't going to take care of who knows how many battery cells all year round. Not to mention the cost of actually walling one in. So while this option was off the table, I knew he was the only one that could help me with my problem. I remembered him telling me the main problem for battery banks was the charging system. And also how he struggled with different methods to improve that, but eventually his 45 years of experience led him to only one conclusion. The only solution for the average user was solar. Standard setup was just not enough, starting from the brilliant design that throws the waves input by converging them. Jack had the idea to focus the sun waves in one spot to increase the overall power output. He then thought of a system to reach his goal, and the most efficient one was using the principle of the satellite dish. That way, he would capture the waves more efficiently. not to mention the space he was saving by rearranging the solar panels at a converging angle. When he presented his idea to his colleagues, everybody, including the top engineers of the time, were shocked to see how easy the working principle really was. That very moment, I realized that the answer I've been searching for so long had been right in front of me, all along. You're probably thinking that there's no way such a common thing like a solar panel could hold the key to energy independence and self-sustenance. But the initial tests have been pretty promising. Let me explain the working principle as I later discovered it. As you probably already know, solar panels capture the solar rays and transform them into electricity. But not all panels use the full capacity of that powerful energy. The real secret lies in taking advantage of their full potential. And my uncle discovered the ingenious method to redirect the rays in such a way that it can turbocharge the whole system. Moreover, this brilliant idea takes up such little space, it can be installed almost anywhere. Without a wasted second, I took some time off and told my wife and daughters I was going to visit their aunt. I kissed them goodbye and swore myself I wouldn't come back without a solution. I went to Elm City, North Carolina, and talked with Amy, my late uncle's wife. She let me in on my uncle's old study, and after many hours of going through dozens of projects, I found what I was looking for. I skimmed them over and I realized that they held the key to take control energy-wise. But what I didn't know exactly was how to capture this unique energy and how to build the device to meet my needs. I struggled to understand the plans for about a week when Amy suggested calling Jason Newman, my uncle's best friend who had worked with him. She told me he was one of the best engineers at the lab. I called and told him my story and asked if he could help me decipher the plans my uncle left. Being an enthusiast in the field, he agreed. However, I insisted to set some basic rules. The device had to be incredibly cheap to build. I was already over my budget with the research, the trip, and everything. It had to be very easy to build so that I could explain it to my wife and kids to build if, God forbid, something were to happen to me. So we started working on the project together. As a guy who studied energy sources with my uncle, Jason had a pretty good idea of the science behind how to get the most energy with this principle, and the plans clearly showed that. The first models we made were either too expensive or too complicated for me to build. We had some heated arguments, mainly because of me being stubborn. I needed the device to be cheap and simple. In the end, after several attempts, we finally came up with a prototype that seemed to be what we were looking for. The design was brilliant. And combined, these materials cost just around $200. However, I'm sure we could have found the parts at a junkyard for free if we weren't in a rush. But the most important part is that it was incredibly safe. No fire, no dangerous fumes released, so we had zero worry about creating a dangerous explosive reaction. You simply had to place the components in the correct position. And because of the ingenious way the device was designed, it generated an extraordinary amount of energy, which was then captured and converted into usable electricity. Even more, the system was actually incredibly easy to hook up to any device. Even if you're terrible at building stuff and have trouble plugging in a DVD player to your TV. So after building the device, the next step was to test it out to see if it really worked as well as we thought it would. We connected a car battery to it, and we just couldn't believe our eyes. The system was capturing the beautiful and powerful yellow solar rays, and because of the brilliant design my uncle had come up with, all of that energy was put immediately to use, providing a steady, robust supply of electricity, turning on the light. We hooked it up to a bunch of appliances, and Amy had the garage lit up to see if it holds. At the same time, the system was capturing the energy of the sun, supplying everything, without the help of any external power. And not only